At the outset, I must thank Dr. Anuj and Dr. Panda for having invited me to give a talk here. Are my slides visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, the topic given to me is dangers in darkness. OSA, dangers in darkness is the obstructive sleep apnea and how to control the risks. What is obstructive sleep apnea? It's a repeated partial or complete obstruction of upper airways during sleep. So the patient can't get enough breath. OSA is a highly prevalent disorder which affects several body systems. And the most dangerous complication of untreated OSA primarily include three body systems: metabolic, cardiovascular, and CNS. So complication-wise, if you look at metabolic, it causes insulin resistance. So obviously diabetes, new onset diabetes can come in. Existing diabetes will be worsened. You could have a metabolic syndrome, probably.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir, but yeah, your slides also not moving, sir. It is actually not on the slideshow mode as per the.
No, but see, is it moving? See?
No, it's still not on the first slide. Dangers in darkness, OSA, how to control the risks.
Okay.
So the yes, now it's.
Yeah. Now it's in.
Yeah.
At the time of share screen, you have to select the PowerPoint presentation with the slideshow mode.
Okay, I think I'll.
Yes.
Let me do that again.
You can stop share and go back again. Yes.
Stop share.
Okay, then minimize your Zoom and put a PPT on your presentation mode or a slideshow.
No, I'll share screen now.
No, sir. Just minimize the Zoom as well and go to your presentation and make on a slideshow mode. Then come back to the Zoom.
Slideshow mode from the beginning.
Yes, from the beginning. Yes. No. From current slide. Okay. Now come back to the Zoom.
Okay, this
is at the time of share screen, you have to select PowerPoint presentation with slideshow mode. See.
Okay. Kushal, where is that button? Please tell sir, where is the button?
There is a green button.
No, wait.
Green button, share screen button.
Yes, share screen.
Yeah.
Now, can you see my slide?
Yes.
And now does it move?
No, it's not moving. Sir, you have to select PowerPoint presentation slideshow mode.
No,
at the time of sharing. So click on that from the beginning or from current slide. Yes.
Slideshow from the beginning.
Yes.
Okay. Right. Now can you see? Does it move?
No, sir. No.
No?
No.
Stop share. Now I go to share screen.
Yes, there is a two PowerPoint over there, if you can see.
No, this is, I have selected the share slide. Then I say slide show. Ye kuch naya system kya hai kya? This never used to have that.
नहीं कुछ नया सिस्टम नहीं किया है सर वो उसमें क्या हुआ है कि आप जो भी
नाउ कैन यू सी द स्लाइड
सर वी कैन सी योर स्लाइड बट नॉट सी योर स्लाइड शो मोड ओनली
नाउ डज इट मूव नाउ I'll speak on this. So I said most dangerous thing is this. You have the metabolic part, which I just discussed, insulin resistance, diabetes, metabolic syndrome, weight gain, sexual dysfunction, etc. And you have the cardiovascular, that is hypertension, arrhythmia, rhythmic problems, cerebrovascular events. Can you see me on screen? No. Myocardial infarction, heart failure. Yeah, I think this is not going proper. Let me share screen again. Yes, can you see my slide now?
Yes, sir.
And does it move?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, it's okay. Moving. It's moving.
Fine. The others are behavioral and neurological, excessive daytime sleepiness. This is what the complications of OSA are. Now, OSA and type 2 diabetes, what causes what? OSA leads to diabetes. There have been many studies which have shown that those patients who are OSA have a greater risk of becoming diabetics. Obviously, they are more obese. They have a metabolic syndrome and they have other comorbidities. And this is another study. A meta-analysis has confirmed that moderate to severe OSA is associated with greater risk of diabetes when compared with the absence of those patients without OSA. So the relationship is bidirectional. It is interesting that both OSA and type 2 diabetes are associated with similar comorbidities, and some of which include hypertension, cardiovascular disease, dyslipidemia, CKD. These are all intertwined. And many of the ongoing trials are focusing on whether having both OSA and type 2 diabetes is associated with greater severity of comorbid conditions compared to either OSA or type 2 diabetes alone. So when you have both of them together, probably there is a greater risk of further complication. So what is the effect of OSA on type 2 diabetes? Several studies have shown that the link between OSA and poor glycemic control, HbA1c controls are poor, fasting glucose levels increase, and variation in glucose level. Glucose variability is very high. Following adjustment with several confounding factors, they've still found that this holds true. The OSA severity and insulin resistance, whenever there is OSA, and the increase in apnea hypopnea index was associated with the worsening of insulin resistance independent of the obesity of that patient. So OSA itself is a trigger to increase insulin resistance. The Southeast Asian study, a linear correlation exists between OSA parameters and insulin resistance. So all these studies are showing us that OSA is a risk factor for developing diabetes, plus it is a risk factor for causing uncontrolled hyperglycemia by way of increasing insulin resistance. OSA and diabetes complications, what happens to them? Hypertension is a comorbid, means it's an associated thing with diabetes. So is it an associated factor with OSA? OSA is independent risk factor for hypertension. And in type 2 diabetes, OSA treatment with CPAP has been shown to reduce the mean arterial pressure, systolic blood pressure, as well as the diastolic blood pressure, telling us that once you control the OSA or treat the OSA, there are beneficial effects which are seen on hypertension. Diabetes has microvascular complications. Let us look at retinopathy. The earlier evidence indicates an association between OSA and more advanced diabetic retinopathy, such as pre-proliferative, proliferative, and even maculopathy. Nephropathy, OSA is associated with CKD, and it can worsen CKD by leading to a decline in the eGFR. So treatment of OSA with CPAP has a beneficial effect on the eGFR. Neuropathy, early evidence on the effect of OSA on diabetic neuropathy shows that OSA is associated with lower intraepidermal nerve fiber density, foot insensitivity, and diabetic peripheral neuropathy. CPAP may contribute to better management of foot ulcers in such patients. Now, obstructive sleep apnea and cardiovascular disease. The presence of OSA is shown to increase the risk of stroke, coronary artery disease, myocardial infarction, and even heart failure. And CPAP has been shown to delay or prevent the occurrence of cardiovascular disease. Now, obstructive sleep apnea and cardiovascular disease, the American Heart Association scientific statement. It says that OSA prevalence is high, 40 to 80% in patients with hypertension, heart failure, coronary artery disease, pulmonary hypertension, those with atrial fibrillation and stroke. 40 to 80% of this category of patients have an associated OSA. That is the thing. So screening is recommended for patients with OSA whose blood pressure, hypertension, pulmonary hypertension, or they get repeated episodes of atrial fibrillation, or in patients with new NYHA class 2 or 4 heart failure, you should always look at a formal sleep assessment. And that is a very reasonable approach in all these patients. In patients with tachybrady syndrome or ventricular tachycardia or survivors of sudden cardiac death in whom sleep apnea is suspected after a comprehensive sleep assessment, evaluation of sleep apnea should be considered. Again, after stroke, clinical equipoise exists with respect to screening and treatment. Patients with nocturnally occurring angina, myocardial infarction, arrhythmia. So basically, any of these conditions, you should always suspect the possibility of OSA, which is aggravating the existing underlying situation. So recommendation for screening for OSA. So you screen for OSA when you have a resistant or poorly controlled hypertension in spite of polytherapy. If there is significant pulmonary hypertension, if there is recurrent atrial fibrillation after either cardioversion or even ablation. So those you should definitely screen for OSA. You should consider sleep study if concerning signs, symptoms of sleep apnea are present, especially if you have NYHA class 2 to 4 heart failure symptoms, tachybrady syndromes, sick sinus syndrome, ventricular tachycardia, survivors of sudden death, and stroke. So all these neurocardio problems, you should keep your suspicion high for presence of OSA. Now, what is the approach towards the patient with OSA? The risk factors are many. Smoking, obesity. Obesity is a very important aspect. Increasing age, male gender, anatomic and abnormalities of the upper airway, family history of sleep problem, alcohol or sedative abuse. So you have alcohol, sedative abuse, smoking, obesity, increasing age. These are the most common and important risk factors for OSA. What are the signs, symptoms? I think everybody knows excessive daytime drowsiness or sleepiness, loud snoring while sleeping, observed episodes of breathing cessation during sleep. So you have to talk to the relative, especially the wife or husband, depending on who the patient is, whether during sleep, you know, you have bouts of snoring going on and then suddenly there is a lull. There is sudden silence and there is a choking and gasping and suddenly they restart breathing again with as if the motor has restarted. So abrupt awakening accompanied by gasping or choking. Awakening with a dry mouth or a sore throat. This is another very important thing because these patients tend to very often have mouth breathing, which leads to a dry mouth. Morning headache is because they have not had a good sleep, so they get a morning headache. Difficulty concentrating during the day because there is somnolence, there is drowsiness. They are not up to the mark. Experiencing mood changes such as depression or irritability. Blood pressure can go up. Nighttime sweating and decreased libido. These are the common signs and symptoms which should make suspect that the patient may have OSA. There is a stop bank questionnaire to assess the risk of OSA. This is a very simple thing. There are 8 parameters here. Each one has got one mark. Snoring, do you snore loudly? Tiredness, do you feel tired or fatigued during the daytime? If has anybody observed this apnea during sleep, like I just mentioned earlier. High blood pressure, BMI more than 35, some authorities say more than 30, age more than 50, neck circumference more than 40 centimeters, that's a huge neck, gender male, and each of this will be given 1 point. So scoring pattern is 0 to 2, very low risk, 2 to 4 is intermediate risk, and above 5 is high risk. So this is a stop bank question. And that stop bank comes from these letters which are black, marked in dark. You have the Malampatti score, obstructive sleep apnea and diagnosis. And this is clinical examination. Class 1, if you ask the patient to open the mouth and you see there is a complete visualization of the soft palate, that's class 1. There is complete visualization of the uvula, that is class 2. Visualization only of the base of the uvula, and class 4 soft palate is not visible at all. So these would be the grades for this is the Malampatti score. You have a modified Malampatti score wherein there's a body mass index more than 36, neck circumference more than 40. Modified Malampatti score is 3 to 4. Now, diagnosis of OSA. The classic diagnosis is a sleep study done in a proper sleep lab with a polysomnography. It consists usually of 24 channels along with audiovisual recording of the complete study, and that is the gold standard for OSA. However, the study is very costly. In our institution, it would cost about 25,000 rupees for a night to have the study done. It's cumbersome, requires hospital stay for one night, requires resource rich setup to conduct the study. As opposed to this, now we have a portable at-home monitoring which can be done. That's an apnea link air study where you just attach a recorder, you have a finger pulse oximeter, and there is a nasal oxygen catheter like thing which is all recorded through this, and just overnight, and it's relatively cheap, and there are a lot of pharmaceutical companies which are doing it free for your patients. So this apnea air link study in diabetes, IDF recommends that screening of people with type 2 diabetes with OSA, and recommends a practical approach which is to investigate this patient with classical symptoms when surgery. So the screening strategy uses a two-pronged approach. Structured questionnaire, that is a stop bank. If you have a stop bank more than 5 or more than 3, you start suspecting. And then for high risk, going for the apnea link air oximeter and portable monitoring system, which can be done at home. And this is how the report of that apnea link air monitoring comes. It's simple, easy to read. It gives you an apnea hypopnea index. There is subclassification of apneas into obstructive, central, mixed, unclassified. It is important to know because you could have obstructive wherein you need a CPAP, a central, you would need a BiPAP rather than a CPAP. And you have oxygen desaturation index, pulse variation, and a snapshot for the whole night. So all these parameters can come in, and basically the apnea hypopnea index is what you really look at. So how do you measure OSA? You look at the apnea hypopnea index, and that will tell you the level of severity. 0 to 5 is normal, 5 to 20 is mild apnea, 20 to 40 moderate, and more than 40 is severe. And how do you calculate the apnea hypopnea index? The sleep duration is 6 hours, and you have 125 apneas and 75 hypopneas. So that makes it 200. So 200 divided by 6 is 33. That is the apnea hypopnea index. It's a very simple calculation which is done. And the treatment option is a CPAP, is the gold standard treatment for OSA. Along with CPAP, obviously, you have to have lifestyle modification, sleep hygiene, weight loss should be advised in all patients who have obstructive sleep apneas. Some other treatment options are also available for OSA, but these would be for mild to moderate OSA, not the severe varieties. You could have dental appliances, about which I will talk later. Surgeries in select groups. Most of the surgeries have not given any decent results at all. So it is very difficult to really recommend anybody for surgeries. Conservative measures such as alcohol sedation, smoking sedation, and nasal decongestants are all part of routine advice. So what is the mechanism of action of the CPAP? If you look at this, this is obstructive airway. This is the airway, your nasal coming here. But here there is a block. It doesn't permit air to flow smoothly from here. But if you give a positive airway pressure, that opens up that passage and the patient can breathe comfortably and sleep comfortably. This is how the nasal prongs, there are the nasal pillows which are available, and there is a whole face mask also available. So positive airway pressure, OSA may benefit from positive airway pressure. In this treatment, a machine delivers air pressure through a piece that fits into your nose or is placed over your nose and mouth while you sleep. The positive air pressure reduces the number of respiratory events that occur as you sleep. So the common type is called continuous positive airway pressure, CPAP. With this treatment, the pressure in the air breath in is continuous, constant, and somewhat greater than that of the surrounding air, which is just enough to keep that upper airway passage open. This air pressure prevents obstructive sleep apnea and snoring, and this is the treatment for OSA. There are different types of CPAP machines. The best is probably an automatic CPAP machine, which adjusts the pressure accordingly, according to the need. You could have some oral devices. This is for mild to moderate thing, wherein you have, it is designed to keep the throat open. Some devices keep your airway open by bringing your lower jaw forward. You know, it causes prognathism, thereby increasing the passage. But this is for mild to moderate. This is the kind of dental aperture things that can be put, fitted into the teeth. And this protrudes the lower jaw out, thereby opening this passage. Effect of CPAP on type 2 diabetes. What happens when you have new onset diabetes is reduced significantly. HbA1c improves with regular CPAP treatment. Effect of CPAP in diabetes control, HbA1c fasting, plasma insulin resistance, all improve once the patient is regularly on a CPAP. What are the adverse effects of CPAP therapy or positive airway pressure therapy? You can have nasal congestion, rhinorrhea, nasal dryness, sinus pain, and even epistaxis. I have seen a patient with severe epistaxis following this because it just dries up the nasal mucosa and can cause abrasion and nasal and epistaxis. Mask discomfort, use suitable mask interface, skin breakdown, gel and air cushion can be used, mask claustrophobia. Many patients just can't sleep with the mask on. They're claustrophobic. So there you have to look at some other options for them. Pressure intolerance, difficult insulation. These all depend on the kind of, if you have an auto-PAP machine, this problem should not come. Mouth breathing, then you need to have a chin strap, full face or oronasal mask. Again, you'll have the problem of mask claustrophobia and bed partner intolerance. The wife or the husband says, "Arey, what the hell this machine is going on?" You have to have a switch near the bed. The pipes will come and there is a disturbance there. So all these have to be taken into account. So you have modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors. Basic lifestyle modification is weight loss, regular exercise, no drinking, no alcohol. And modifiable risk factors are obesity, stop smoking, alcohol use especially at bedtime, and upper airway collapsibility. Non-modifiable, male sex, older age, genetic factors. So lifestyle changes for milder cases of obstructive sleep apnea, lose weight if you're overweight, exercise regularly, drink alcohol moderately if at all. Don't drink in the hours before bedtime. Quit smoking. Use a nasal decongestant. Don't sleep on your back. Preferably sleep on your side. Avoid taking sedatives. So this is, if these measures don't improve sleep or if apnea is moderate or severe, then recommend other treatments. Certain devices can help open a black. In other cases, surgery may be necessary, but like I said earlier, surgery is the least.
So you have last minute to sum up.
I know, this is my last slide, don't worry. Among surgeries, bariatric surgery probably has a role because it can cause a significant weight loss and that weight loss can benefit these patients with OSA. And a simple thing is, those patients who cannot tolerate the CPAP, they can sleep on the side. When you sleep on the side, the obstruction becomes significantly less. and they could still manage without a CPAP machine. Thank you very much.